Welcome to r/ProRevenge. This is a story of someone getting back at someone with ProRevenge after being wronged. Thank you, friends, for subscribing, likes, and supporting in the comments. And today's first story is... Oh, so you've got strong political backers? You're still going down. Background. This story takes place in Asia, not the US or any other Western country. My wife, late 20s, is working in a newly set up government branch office of only about 20 people, which by virtue of its nature requires a lot of interaction and support from high-ranking politicians and the grassroots. Most of her colleagues are thus seniors and retirees, with a lot of clout in their respective communities and strongly recommended and backed by their area's, sort of the equivalent of a mayor to join the office. More background. When my wife just joined, there was this particular guy, whom we shall call Jack. Jack was in his 60s, coming out of retirement, and was charismatic as heck. He was the undeniable alpha male in the office, and had the respect and support of almost all other colleagues, thanks to him generously buying everyone in his group lunch almost every day. The relatively younger, 30s to 40s ladies even called him Papa Jack or some other endearing term. Even the boss gave him great leeway. Jack could tell off the boss during meetings, and the boss would just suck it up. Now, at this point, all we knew is that Jack was charismatic AF, one of the pastors of a megachurch even, and had the support of a very high-ranking politician. In fact, Jack was apparently very rich and had no need to work this job, but was there due to politics. Also why the boss, who had no political backing, gave him that much leeway. I was in between jobs at this time and helped my wife out at her office from time to time, cultivating a pretty good relationship with her boss. First time I was at her office, Jack came over with his posse, sized me up by asking lots of personal questions, and made some jokes about me. Immediately it rubbed me the wrong way, and he gave me the impression that he was an arrogant pea. However, I gave him the benefit of the doubt, as the other colleagues were quick to praise him, despite his loud mouth. The first time I worked directly with him, however, shattered any illusions I had about his competency. This guy was horribly inept at his work, and got away with it all the time. My wife even told me that she was unhappy about how he would make jokes about her, or even poke her in the belly or arms, and comment on her putting on weight. She, however, still gave him the benefit of the doubt, as he mentioned that he saw her as a daughter, and perhaps being childish was just part of his joker attitude. The incident. Couple months later, it was Jack's birthday, and most of the office, except the boss, attended after work. My wife got him a gift, as did everyone else, and he thanked her by plying her with expensive wine. Now, my wife is not a good drinker, and everyone in the office knew it, but was still pressured into drinking. Towards the end of the party, he offered to drive my wife and some other colleagues staying nearby home. My wife agreed, as it was in a group, and it was way too late and expensive to go by public transport, and her cell phone was dead. However, instead of dropping my wife off first, as her house was the nearest, he ended up dropping everyone else first and drove her somewhere deserted instead of home. He then sexually harassed her, saying that he thought she was sexy, admitted to purposely plying her with alcohol, and that he really wanted to touch her. My wife was massively drunk, but thankfully fended off his advances and repeatedly asked to be driven home. Perhaps also driven by her latent unhappiness about the way he treats her at work, she reminds him of his religious work and his being a grandfather, such that he finally gave up and dropped her off somewhere not deserted, whereby she walked home and quickly called me. I rushed over, and she related the whole incident, still tipsy AF. I called up her relatively good friend at work, whom I thought would be trustworthy, but the spineless fellow advised not to go against Jack and just let it go, since nothing happened. Fine, time to plot my revenge myself. The corporate compromise. The next day I made a big show out of asking her boss out to discuss something. Jack was noticeably on leave, and the rest of the office was also acting oddly. I was surprised that her boss believed me right off the bat, since he said he had spotted Jack leering at young women all the time, and that Jack had a reputation for being a philanderer. Jack was apparently not independently rich, too. He was supported generously by his rich wife, who turned a blind eye to his side activities. Why? Because she was much younger than him, and he had supported her through college with his payback then. Now that she's successful, she feels that she owes it to him. However, boss man was apparently scared of the political repercussions from taking action against Jack, but promised to keep an eye on him and let my wife telecommute to work instead. Still, boss man had to inform his boss as part of protocol, who totally lost his SH. As an ex-military guy and new to this job, this guy was hungry for blood and hadn't yelled at anyone in years. So Jack was basically called in and interrogated until he admitted to getting her drunk, but maintained that he only wanted to talk to her about the problems they were having at work, with no sexual intention. With no evidence and having an SH ton of political pressure harping on this point, ex-military boss could do nothing about this guy either. So he said we either had to make a police report so that he could act or accept a half-aid private apology from Jack, restricted to only what he admitted to. No way in heck was I going to accept that. Ex-mill boss came up with some other alternatives, such as transferring my wife out, but she did nothing wrong. But nothing was acceptable to me, except totally neutering this guy. Fire his A or destroy his life, such that he would have no way of preying on my wife or the other young women he worked with. Later I would come to know that Jack had told everyone that my wife was trying to seduce him for his money, but he rejected her. He ruined her reputation to save himself, and the bosses couldn't do SH about it? Nobody sullies my wife's reputation and gets away with it. The Revenge Part 1. Social Isolation. I knew where my revenge would hit him the hardest, his pride. I countered, demanding that Jack make a public apology in the office for what happened that night. As promised, he would not be obliged to apologize for anything he did not admit to, including sexual harassment. In fact, I told him that he could just apologize without any reason given. I didn't need one. Jack tried to weasel his way out of this, but even his backer couldn't deny such a simple, reasonable request. And apologize he did. Thanks to his own pre-poisoning of the well of public opinion, most of the office saw through his lies. Why would he be forced to apologize if he did nothing wrong? What was he even apologizing for? Why can't it be said outright? Immediately after, the office was split, half sided with my wife, while half stuck with their beloved Papa Jack, who could do no wrong. The mutters and gossip against him grew steadily though, as his background and past philandering reputation started leaking out. I might have been part of these leaks, who knows? In the end, the cognitive dissonance and or their willingness to be associated with a pervert for free lunches lost out to public opinion. Soon Jack found himself increasingly isolated and eating lunch with only his work partner. The alpha male was neutered. Nobody took his bragging seriously. He had no pack of fans anymore. Nobody was picking up the slack of his incompetent work except his partner, who was backed by the same politician. The Revenge Part 2. Spectacular Career End. I spoke to Jack during one of his lonely lunches, telling him that he had only one choice, to resign quietly. I knew this would hurt Jack's pride the most, peeving him off. So Jack did not go quietly. He set about messing up the office, shredding important documents, damaging equipment, etc. I went straight to his partner and told him that there were documents missing and having covered for him, he would be liable for any sabotage in the upcoming audit. His partner tried to pin it on me, but I had already extracted and backed up the security tapes, showing Jack shredding the documents literally behind his partner's back. His partner, now burdened with Jack's mess and about to get audited, thanks to me whispering in boss man's ear, had to rat Jack out to the politician to save him. The politician quickly distanced himself publicly from Jack, and more than likely told him to hand in his resignation before the audit. Jack was now entirely cut off. No job, no political backer, no friends at work. The only thing he had now was his wife, kids, and grassroots community reputation. Was I done? Not by a long shot. The Revenge Part 3. Stealing his wallet. I knew his wife would not care about Jack's philandering ways, and his kids probably already knew anyway. However, the wife would be concerned if he was spending her money all willy-nilly. I volunteered to send the usual office goodbye card to Jack, but mistakenly addressed it to his wife. Oops, careless me. Most colleagues adding generic messages, such as all the best to it. But I added an anonymous message telling him how he missed the lavish meals and parties we had with him, before his retirement and all the good times, while also stating that how all the ladies missed their papa. Never heard any news about him for months, so I assumed the wife had ignored the message. Until yesterday. The Revenge Part 4. Goodbye, reputation. Opened the papers to see that dear Papa Jack was in prison for a year due to some minor offense. Dug deeper and found out that Jack did indeed have his allowance cut by his wife. Unable to sustain his lavish lifestyle, he turned to crime. I found out from the grapevine that he had actually done some pretty major stuff, but somehow managed to get it down to a minor offense, barely footnoted in the papers, perhaps by the politician not wanting to be associated negatively with a former right-hand person. Was I done? Yeah, I suppose this would do for now. The second story is, don't hit my guys. Previous boss walked into the office where I was team lead over three engineers. I was out at the time, but heard this from the victim. Boss was angry about a mistake one of my guys made on an architectural plot. Not a mistake, but a failure to use telepathy. Boss got so angry that while standing behind the seated engineer, he punched the guy in the side of the head. As if immediately realizing what he did was wrong, he said fix it, then left for the day. I got back to the office soon after, and they told me what happened. We made a pact that if he ever puts hands on one of us, we'd all stand up and put him down hard, and back each other up. Well, it never came to that. After approaching upper management and HR, I got the runaround on reporting the incident. They all basically said, if it was that bad, then report it to the police, but he's too high in the political structure to fire for this. Unhappy with that answer, and with my guy unwilling to involve the police, was set a plan into action. We invited his boss, the district manager, to see the progress we had made on a day when boss wasn't around. During this, I asked the DM to have skip level one-on-ones with my guys, saying that it would be good for morale. He agreed. Each one of my guys opened with, The biggest concern I have is that boss man punched Tony a couple months ago, and HR told us they couldn't do anything about it. How can you ensure my safety? I got called in and said my story, but had to say I wasn't there. I had tried to report it up through the proper channels and failed. I was told it was political suicide for my entire team if I was to push it. District manager didn't buy into the political BS. He made things happen. We agreed that my guys should not be in fear of physical attack. I also had DM's backing in case of political fallout, and he was a personal friend of the CEO, so that was good enough protection. Boss man was walked out and trespassed. Boom, headshot. Don't hit my guys. And the last story is, I had to wait 2 years, but what goes around comes around. This all started about 2 years ago. I was working full-time security at a busy level 1 trauma center in the Midwest. Our security department had its own union that was run by two night shift guys. Unfortunately, they were not responsive to union issues. I was approached by some of the old school day shift guys and asked to spearhead an attempt at getting these two union guys to respond to requests for a union meeting to address long overdue issues. Needless to say, they refused to even communicate. At one point, I simply asked for the email list so that I could send out a group message. It should be noted that I couldn't use our company email, as it's forbidden for union purposes. Well, of course, there was no response to my request, so I printed out the message and put them in everyone's lockers instead. Not long after, my locker started getting filled with shredded paper and whatever else could fit through the air vents. Not surprisingly, this was happening during the night shift. One day, they caught me in a not-so-good mood. During shift change at 6 a.m., I opened my locker and was pretty peeved off, to once again find it filled with SH. I came out from the locker area and went face-to-face with one of the union reps. Admittedly, I was pretty heated and chest-bumped him once while telling him to knock that SH the F off. A quick side note, this guy was a tough guy when he had backup, dealing with patients or visitors, and he also had several complaints of excessive use of force. He had a pretty scared look on his face. Evidently, he felt my actions were so egregious that it necessitated calling the manager, who was on vacation outside of the country. He also felt it necessary to file a complaint with HR. When the time came for a write-up, even the manager said he didn't want to do it, but had to because HR was already involved. Fast forward about 2 years. This night shift union guy has applied with a law enforcement agency. Recently, he has an unfortunate incident caught on tape, where he basically took down someone who was on oxygen and in a wheelchair by striking them from behind and then pulling the wheelchair over backwards because the person tossed something in his general direction. It just so happens that I have a very good friend at said law enforcement agency who does background checks. Let's just say this pertinent information was passed along to the appropriate person, effectively eliminating any chance of him being hired. Thank you for listening all the way to the end. Have a good day!